your fingers across the train tracks. Okay?
One more, let's get 35, right here.
Woo!
Oh.
35.
For how many of you is this your first time at the Lobo Field, this field? Well, I have to tell you, Coach Birmingham was telling me he wants it to be like this every single night. He wants this to be a community field that everyone gets to enjoy and bring the whole state literally here. I think we have Vanna White coming up to begin by giving away a few door prizes. Why don't we have one of our baseball players come up here? And by the way, will the baseball players please stand up? This is some baseball team. Lobos, yay! Will one of y'all come up, or a couple of you, please?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Okay, what is your name?
Jalen Whitehead is going to be the first one. He's so good at throwing, he's going to throw out our t-shirts for us.
All right.
Aim towards kids.
All right. T-shirt. Woo!
You wanna stay up and we'll do a drawing.
Hey, come here, Jim. You're gonna help. We have some great door prizes. The first one is in the book.
It's a Dr.
Oh, Dr. Ryan Swanson, who you're going to hear from in a little bit, has donated one of his books.
Plus,
so the first drawing?
Plus some baseball cards and some...
Whoa, baseball cards and bubble gum. What more could you ask?
Okay.
First one. It looks like Floyd Herrera. All right, Floyd. Congratulations. And thank you, Ryan, for your donation. The second? We have one more book. And I bet we have more baseball cards in there, too.
We do.
We do. And gum?
And gum. And Cracker Jacks.
And Cracker Jacks. And the winner is Anthony Clayson. C-L-A-E-S-O-N? Clayson? Oh, Anthony, great! Hey, show everyone your shirt. Turn around and show them your shirt. Yay.
This is from the business cards, and it is Ken Burns Baseball.
Oh, Ken Burns' book called Baseball.
This is from the business cards.
From the business cards, okay. Willa Ortega, Public Health Division, Chronic Disease Prevention and Control Bureau. Willa? Where are you? Is Willa here?
She's eating.
Oh, she's eating.
Must be present to win.
I think if Willa's here, we'll save the book for Willa.
Okay.
Is that it?
That's it. Thank you, Ed.
Thank you all very much, and thank you. So tonight we have a very special night, and I want to ask you, how were those hamburgers from Rex's? Weren't those great? Let's all give Rex's Hamburgers, who volunteered and, by the way, donated all of those this evening. So I will tell you that Hobbs' loss was certainly our game. Coach, where are you? There he is, Coach Birmingham. His first season here was 2008. He was from Hobbs, and there he was actually the coach for a junior college. And of course, we decided he should be the coach for the Lobos. He has achieved much in his years here, but most of all, he's become not only a huge fan of the state and a huge proponent, not just passionate, not just a little bit, but very passionate about UNM, the athletes, and some of the awards that he's won in his tenure here: All-American West Academic Selections, All-American, All-Mountain West Players, we've had a number of them, Mountain West Conference Players of the Year, we've had National Batting Championships, team and individual, Major League Players, and 30-plus win seasons as a Lobo coach. Whoa! Not for 48 straight years had UNM had an NCAA bid, but under his leadership in 2010, we did. He says that baseball, the state of New Mexico, UNM, and the Lobos, and all the athletes are what he is most passionate about. I want to thank him for allowing us this evening to share in some of his passion and to be at his field. He'll be here in a little bit, but I wanted to say thank you, first of all, to Coach. This is his place. Little known fact, when my husband looks at some of the things that we have opportunities to do, he saw this one, he said, I'm going to talk to Coach. So he's a huge fan, and so are all of us. We're going to begin, though, by having a professor who also knows a great deal about sports speak to us a little bit. Dr. Ryan Swanson is an assistant professor in the UNM Honors College. He became interested in baseball history while writing his dissertation in American history at Georgetown. Having played baseball as a youth, Ryan could not help but notice the preposterous box scores in 19th century newspapers, oftentimes featuring one team scoring more than 100 runs in a game. That wasn't one my husband played in. His first book, When Baseball Went White, tells the story of how baseball became segregated following the American Civil War. Ryan teaches and researches on sports history. He also directs the Lobo Scholars Program, a collaboration between the Honors College and Athletics Department designed to serve UNM's highest achieving student athletes. Ryan resides with an absolutely wonderful family who's here tonight. And I will tell you, he said that he spent more time at Little League games this year than anyone ought to. So I'm going to ask Ryan to come up here and join us and share some of his wisdom with us.
Thank you. Well, tonight I'm going to share a little bit of baseball history with you. And in particular, I'm going to talk a little bit about the idea of baseball being America's national pastime. Now, here at UNM, I have the good fortune of working with the Lobo Scholars Program. And that's a program that, as was just mentioned, where I get to work with our highest achieving student athletes. And on that front, let me tell you that student athletes here at UNM are doing really amazing things in the classroom, as well as doing amazing things like winning Mountain West Championships and going to the national tournament. So that's really a great pleasure that I have. Another, a little more? Okay. Let's see. See if I'm, there we go. A little taller. I'm a sports historian, so I study and research and write and teach about sports. And so in that kind of job, and yes, that's a real job, I have the good fortune to talk about baseball in a lot of great places, academic conferences, in the classroom, but I must say that this is hands down the best speaking venue that I've ever had. Standing here at home plate, yeah. You know, the sun's about to set. I've got baseball players who can correct me if I get any of the details wrong. So it's really just a pleasure to be here with you all tonight. Now, what I'm going to talk about comes from a scholarly perspective, yes, but also from a personal perspective. I came to love baseball during the summer of 1988. I was staying with my grandparents in Pasadena, California, and my grandfather introduced me to the game of baseball. He taught me about Vin Scully, and he got me reading Jim Murray in the LA Times. He introduced me to Dodger Dogs and Dodger Stadium. And during that summer of 1998, Oral Hershiser, as some of you may know, was in the midst of a pretty good streak. He threw 59 consecutive scoreless innings, and then the Dodgers went on to win the World Series. And since I had been a fan for all of a couple months, I thought that was kind of a personal victory there. So I've got that personal love for the game. I've also, as was mentioned, spent a lot of time lately with little baseball players. My boys both play Little League Baseball, and so I really love the game from that perspective as well. But I'm going to talk about the idea of baseball being our national pastime. And quickly I'll mention that there are some critics to this idea. I'm not going to spend much time on the critics, because anybody who makes a full criticism of baseball as a national pastime probably has a kind of sad and depressing life. But what I will say is that the critics will point out things like some recent polling data. The New York Times put a poll out last year asking people what their favorite sport was. And 67% of Americans said football was their favorite sport. Other people will point to youth participation statistics. You might not know that Little League Baseball has fallen to third. Actually, if you take youth participation in sports ages 18 and under, every year 6.9 million young Americans play basketball. Every year 6.6 million youth participate in soccer. And then baseball comes in third at 5.6 million. But what I would say to the critics who point to those kinds of things and viewer statistics in terms of television revenue and those kinds of things is that baseball's connection with the United States has always been about more than the numbers. Baseball has deep roots, deep tradition, shared experiences, and baseball's even filled with some myths and some lies that we love to tell ourselves year after year. So what I'm going to do here is just give you three stories that explain how baseball came to be regarded as America's national pastime. So let me start at the beginning, or nearly the beginning. Shortly after the Civil War was over, baseball boomed. And right after the Civil War was over, baseball essentially gave itself the nickname the national pastime. Soldiers came home from war, and they put away their guns, and many of them picked up bats and balls. In 1865, baseball clubs formed by the hundreds around the United States. The game quickly became very popular, and it also became more organized. And initially, in 1865, 1866, there were actually two competing versions of baseball out there. There was the New York game, and there was the Massachusetts game. Baseball's always been about the American League East, I guess. So there's these two competing games at this point. The essential difference is the Massachusetts game has a different field configuration. Rather than the layout like we're sitting on here, home plate stood as kind of a fifth base, and then you had the other four bases. The other big difference between the New York and Massachusetts game was in the Massachusetts game, you could pick up a hit ball and you could hit the running base runner with the ball to get them out. So it was a little bit more violent, and the New York game won out. So baseball is becoming more organized. It's becoming very much more popular. And almost immediately after the Civil War is over, this phrase is being used increasingly, the national pastime. Promoters are using it, and journalists are using it quite a bit. And as the game's becoming more popular and people are calling it the national pastime, the idea even begins to percolate that baseball might be the national salve to bring the nation back together. All right, the Civil War, as we all know, was very costly. 750,000 Americans died. And when the war was over, a couple of things were decided. The nation was going to stay together. Slavery was not going to be part of the nation, but that doesn't mean that everybody immediately started getting along again. So there's this hope that the national pastime is going to bring us back together. And there's a famous journalist by the name of Henry Chadwick at this time who, you know, no shame, he calls himself the father of baseball. You know, he gives himself that title. And he has a saying about baseball. He says baseball has no north, no south, no east, and no west. And in saying that, he is going with this idea of the national pastime. It's going to bring us all back together. So continuing on after the Civil War, in 1876, the National League is formed. In 1882, the American Association, which will become the American League, is formed. And then in 1903, we have the first World Series. And all during this time, this phrase is being used increasingly in newspapers, the national pastime, the national pastime. It's what's bringing us together. And really during this period of the 19th century, baseball reigns really unchallenged as the most popular sport in the United States. Now, at the turn of the century, 1905, some questions begin to arise about whether baseball is truly American, all right? And these kind of debates, you know, they kind of happen today, what's truly American, what's not. They're a little bit cyclical in terms of the way that they work. But in 1905, as these questions are rising, Albert Spalding decides we have to put this to bed once and for all. Now, when I say the name Spalding, what do you think of? Yeah, baseball, sporting goods, right? Albert Spalding is a former baseball player by this time who's a millionaire in the sporting goods industry. So sure, he wants baseball to be the national pastime. He wants it to be purely American because he's making some nice money off of it. So how does he go about trying to prove that baseball is America's national pastime? He does something thoroughly American, puts a committee together to figure out if baseball is indeed America's national pastime. This is a pretty high-powered committee, though. In charge of this committee is Colonel A.G. Mills, so it becomes known as the Mills Commission. And on the committee itself, there are two sitting U.S. senators, there are two former National League commissioners, and then there are two famous baseball players, Alfred Reach and George Wright. So, this committee is put together with the job, figure out if baseball is truly American, figure out if it's our national pastime. And they go to work. And for the better part of a year, they gather as much information as they can about baseball. They put ads in hundreds of newspapers all around the country asking for letters to be sent back to the commission to figure out what's going on. And a year into this, they don't really have what they're looking for. They don't have a definitive storyline. They don't have this silver bullet they're looking for until they get a letter from an elderly gentleman named Abner Graves. And one of the strange things about this story is there's two Abners involved. Abner Graves writes a letter to the Mills Commission saying, I know exactly when baseball started. He says, back in 1839, when I was a young man in Cooperstown, New York, I had a friend who was named, anybody know? Abner Doubleday, the other Abner. And Abner Doubleday, he said, sketched out on a piece of paper the rules for the game that we know as baseball. And so the Mills Commission took this letter from Abner Graves and said, great, we now know that baseball was created by Americans for Americans, and it's our national pastime. And that Doubleday myth stuck. Now, there are a couple problems with the Doubleday story, as you probably know. Abner Graves himself, shortly after sending that letter to the Mills Commission, he kills his wife and is then committed to a mental institution. So he's not a great source for this idea, but nevertheless, it sticks. Now, how many of you have taken a trip to Cooperstown, New York, to the Baseball Hall of Fame? All right, some of you? All right, if I wanted to be a critic, if I wanted to be mean, I suppose I could say, congratulations, you've taken a trip based on a lie. But that's not really true. The Doubleday story is part of the mythology that really makes baseball America's national pastime. So that's the first story. Second, so if we've got baseball becoming popular after the American Civil War, this idea of the national pastime being really used over and over, and then you've got the Mills Commission, which kind of solidifies it as much as possible, the next thing that really makes baseball America's national pastime is the home run, all right, the long ball, particularly those long balls hit by Babe Ruth. Now, some of you might remember about 5 or 6 years ago, Nike had an advertising campaign that featured Tom Glavine and Greg Maddux, the pitchers for the Atlanta Braves. And in this ad, they're really frustrated because they're out there on the field not getting any attention while Mark McGwire and Sammy Sosa, so this must have been a ways back, are getting all the attention. And so the ad goes forward and you've got Tom Glavine and Greg Maddux. They're hitting the weights. They're getting in the batting cages. They're getting all these tips so they can start hitting home runs. And so at the end of this advertisement, the tagline is, quote, chicks dig the long ball. Now, I have no scholarly opinion on whether or not that is true. But what I will tell you is that in the 1920s and 1930s, Americans dug the long ball. And they dug Babe Ruth. Babe Ruth broke into baseball in 1914. He spends a couple years with the Boston Red Sox before he is sold to the New York Yankees, unfortunately for the Red Sox. And Babe Ruth comes along at exactly the perfect time. There's a new invention which is changing the way that Americans are experiencing sports. Radios are now in most American homes. So for the first time, Americans can not only read about a home run, kind of in the box score, but they can hear it as it's going on. There's a little bit of color that goes with these feats that are happening. Now, Babe Ruth not only hits home runs, but he's the perfect American story. He's kind of a Horatio Alger, rags to riches story. And just briefly, I'm sure many of you are familiar with his story, but Babe Ruth is born in Baltimore, Maryland. He has a pretty tough upbringing. He spends most of his early years in his parents' saloon, kind of just being ignored for the most part. He gets in enough trouble that he's sent away to a home for incorrigible youth. And basically, his parents put him off in this institution and really forget about him. They never visit, despite the fact that he's nearby. But while he's there, out of these difficult circumstances, Babe Ruth makes something of himself. He's taken under the wing of Brother Matthias there at the institution. He learns how to be a tailor. Interestingly enough, he'll tailor his own suits throughout his major league career because he takes pride in it. And he learns how to hit a baseball, and he learns some rudimentary academic skills. And so Ruth arrives in the major leagues in 1914, and everything about him is big. He swings big. He misses big. He's a legendarily big eater. You know, we just had hot dogs in there. Supposedly, at one point in one meal, Babe Ruth had 18 hot dogs. So the guy could eat. He's a legendary womanizer. But his story just reverberates with Americans. He becomes the most famous American connecting his story to baseball. He plays in New York, which of course matters, and he does things that are seemingly so far out of reach that Americans can't help but look. Babe Ruth hits, anybody know how many home runs he hits in his career? 714. The previous record, he just beats the previous record by a smidge. The previous record was 138 home runs. Babe Ruth hit 60 home runs in one season. The previous record was 27 home runs. So it would be equivalent to somebody coming out, you know, this coming season in the major leagues and hitting 120 home runs. It was just out of sight kind of where he was putting these records. And Babe Ruth himself is a perfect manifestation of this national pastime, this mix of myth and reality. You've heard some of the stories that we'd love to be true. We've heard the story about Babe Ruth going to visit a sick child in the hospital. So what does he tell that child? Here's what I'm going to do for you, little Johnny. I'm going to hit a home run so that you feel better. And he goes out the next day and hits not one home run, but three home runs. We like to think that's true, and it might be true. Stories like Babe Ruth calling his shot and hitting the home run. Babe Ruth becomes this icon who sells baseball even further and solidifies the game even further in the American psyche. Babe Ruth is still an American icon. He's been dead now nearly, 75 years plus, and his name still appears at the top of America's most famous athlete lists. 75 years after he died, one journalist wrote, 75 years after his last game, one journalist wrote this about Babe Ruth. Sports have become a national religion, this scribe wrote, and Babe Ruth is the patron saint. Babe Ruth stands at the heart of the game he played. Babe Ruth is the promise of a warm summer evening, a bag of peanuts, and a beer. And he's a promise of maybe, just maybe, the longest ball ever hit out of the park. So Ruth becomes a personification of this national pastime, this America's game ethic. Now lastly, so if we've got the using of the phrase, and then the Mills Commission to kind of lock it home, and then we've got Babe Ruth who catches everybody's attention, the last part of really solidifying baseball as America's national pastime is the presidency. U.S. presidents give their stamp of approval to baseball in pretty significant ways. In 1910, William Howard Taft starts a tradition of throwing out the first pitch for the major league season. He does this at the National Ballpark in Washington, D.C. Now, he's kind of a funny person to do this, if you know anything about Taft. He's most famous for his, I always tell my boys to be nice about girth, for his girth, right? He gets stuck in a bathtub, supposedly, at one point in his presidency. He really loves to play golf. But on an April day in 1910, he comes to the ballpark. He throws a wobbly first pitch out to Walter Johnson, and in doing so gives another piece of evidence to this idea that this is America's national pastime. Kind of interesting that he does this because he follows the president who most actively dislikes baseball. Theodore Roosevelt loves sports, almost all sports, but he cannot stand baseball. He calls baseball the mollycoddle game, which roughly translated means the sissy game. You know, this is not a game for tough people. This is not a game for Americans. This is a game that we should kind of set aside. So Taft comes along after and starts this tradition, and presidents continue it to this day. A stamp of approval. This is our national pastime. Sitting presidents show up to throw out the first game. One other significant thing to note about the presidency in baseball has to do with World War II. January 1942, just weeks after Pearl Harbor, baseball has a decision to make. The Major League Commissioner at the time, Kennesaw Mountain Landis, writes a letter to the President of the United States, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, asking what should be done in light of the massive war that is to come. You know, the war has been raging, obviously, in Europe for 6 or 7 years. Clearly, the Americans are coming in now post-World, post-Pearl Harbor. So what does the president want baseball to do? So Landis writes, asking FDR, really hinting, should we suspend baseball for the duration of the war? And Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the president of the United States, the commander-in-chief with a big war coming, writes back the very next day and says, among other things, quote, I honestly feel that it would be best for the country to keep baseball going. All right? We've got a war coming, he goes on to say. We need baseball. We have to have baseball. It is our national pastime. So baseball continues on during the war and at the same time sends many of its biggest stars over to serve in the conflict. Ted Williams, Stan Musial, Hank Greenberg, Bob Feller, Joe DiMaggio, among others, go and serve nobly in World War II with the stamp of approval from the president that baseball must go on. So this is kind of the third part of this story of baseball becoming the national pastime. So to wrap up, do I still think that baseball is America's national pastime today? If you're keeping track of the dates here at this point, you notice I stopped in 1946. That was indeed a long time ago, and I'm not here to argue that baseball hasn't changed. It certainly has. But I would say that the traditions that made baseball America's national pastime are still in place. How do you know when it's spring? For many of us, it's when do the pitchers and catchers report to Florida? How do you know when it's really fall? Well, when it's time for the Fall Classic, the World Series. And on the other side of things, if you want to look statistical, baseball remains extraordinarily profitable today. These local contracts, the television contracts that are being signed are really changing the way that baseball works. And pulling things back again just to a personal side of things, I have made the pilgrimage to Cooperstown a number of times. And you might ask, well, why did I make a pilgrimage based on a myth? Did that somehow take away from the meaning of the experience? And I would say absolutely not. Baseball remains our national pastime because there's this reservoir of tradition and custom that makes it important. So, having talked about the national pastime and the presidents and Babe Ruth and the long ball, if I could at this point, it would just be, you know, I'd say, let's play ball, and a game would start out. I don't have nearly that kind of authority, so I won't do that. But I've really appreciated the chance to share a little baseball history with you, and I'll turn it over to Coach to talk more. Thank you.
You're here tonight because you're proud to be a Lobo. That's why you're here, and we should be. And I want to teach our kids that. A famous saying that I go by, and I'm a teacher, I'm not a coach, I'm a teacher. I'm not just teaching baseball. I'm teaching young men how to be men, how to be better in our community, make our community better. That's what we're doing. So the saying goes, my teacher thought I was better than I was, and so I was. And that's what we do here. That's what University of New Mexico is about. Wow. Make sure you're proud about being a Lobo your entire life. And make it contagious. Spread it around. And you ask people, did you go to a football game tonight? No. Why not? You should skip your wedding to go to a football game. Sorry, honey. That's my wife back there. I didn't win a game. That's my wife, Chris, in the turquoise. I didn't win a game until she showed up. I'm so glad you're here. I'm so glad. This feels really, really good, doesn't it? Oh, it feels good. Did you watch the kids play catch?
Yeah.
And the great game of baseball is about that. So, Joe, there you are. Let her rip. So, this game is about dads playing catch with their sons and their daughters. There's a young lady. Come here. You know how to throw now. We just taught her how to throw. Come on. This is not gender related. This game is for everybody. All right. Jump over there by him and play some catch. Now, when we started, as this goes on, dad and son have time together. It's a family sport. Dad, why is the sky blue as they play catch? Dad, why is math so hard as they play catch? And dad, why do the Dallas Cowboys let Tony Romo quarterback all the time? Now, watch this young lady play catch and throw. Sweetheart, is your arm loose a little bit? Are you pretty good and loose? Okay, catch this ball. Okay, now, she couldn't throw it that far. I'm gonna tell you, this game is about work and proper work. And New Mexico kids can go to Omaha and win a championship because this young lady couldn't throw the ball that far when we started, right? Now scoot back and show them. There you go, that's good. Now, do it right. Thumb to thigh, reach for the sky, skip, skip, and let go. Whoop, we didn't skip. No. She's okay, everybody falls down, get back up, and go get them. Skip. Yeah! How about that? Give her a hand. That's why we have the University of New Mexico, for our kids, for us, to get better. Now, we all rally around this institution, it is the flagship institution, and we all chip in and drop anything negative that we have and go, you know what, that's mine, I'm standing up for it, we're gonna fix it. Get involved in everything, biology, English, law, even art. Art is a lawyer, and he had to sign a piece of paper out there today that he wouldn't get hurt. Now, Art, stand up. Art, did you have to sign a piece of paper when you jumped over the bleachers in 1961 and tried to tackle Mazeroski after he hit the home run to bring the World Series and beat the Yankees? Art was there. That's the kid that was running on the field. That's who we are. Let's be excited about each other. We've got special things going on. I want to, Jared Manning, where are you? Come here, cowboy, I want to show you off. I'm so stinking proud of New Mexico. It's unbelievable how cool our kids are. Excuse me, I was an English teacher. New Mexico High School Player of the Year right here, baby, freshman. Remember this name, Jared Manning, because he's going to be a big draft pick. Another one of our All-Americans, and we've had 30 of them since I've been here, and that's pretty cool. Kids walk on that. He's not a walk-on. I had to have him. He's special. Tell you another story. A young kid in this state was a catcher, and he didn't have any scholarships, and he came to see us, said, I'd like to walk on the University of Mexico. And he came early, and we went to work. We thought he had a chance. Now, we had an All-American catcher named Rafael Neda who was catching, and he wasn't going to get in the lineup right away. He was getting a little discouraged. Coach, I don't know if I'm good enough for this. I said, son, you're going to be the best catcher in the United States by what's said and done. We're going to go to work. You have what it takes, and we're going to get this done. So he went to work. His sophomore year, he still wasn't sure of himself, but I kept putting him in there. And we played a schedule because that's who we need to be. Our schedule had 40 top 10 games on it, top 25 games on it. We had a freshman team and we were getting punted. Boom, kick, boom, beat, boom, boom. And it was hard and they were all on the road. Oklahoma, Arizona, Arizona State. David Smidley called me and said, are you crazy? Are you absolutely lost your mind? No. What we were doing is sending a message to these young kids that this is who we are. and we're going to keep doing it. And the bar's not coming down. The bar's not coming down. And I was taking a lot of ridicule, but I was prepared for it. So when we got to the end of the season, this Mitch Garver kid was our catcher. And Mitch Garver's from La Cueva High School. And Mitch Garver started getting it. He goes, you know what? I've been punched, I've been kicked, I've been knocked down, and it's happened over time. Now we're getting up. And in the Mountain West Tournament of 2011, a team full of freshmen and sophomores beat the number one team in the country, TCU, and went on to the NCAA championships. Those group of kids ran off four championships in a row right after that. So here's what I'm telling you I've learned, because this is a classroom. This baseball field is a classroom, and it's used for all. I put AstroTurf on it because it's not just for Lobos. It's for the kids in summer ball, because they look forward to playing out here on something nice. They do. And it's for the state championship series. A ball, double A, triple A. You won your championship here, didn't you, Coach? How cool was it? Yeah, really cool. Because it's for them. It's for all of us. It's for our kids. And I want to build something special for our kids. And if you've seen this before this, you go, oh man, that's sad. That is sad, sad. Because that's what we have to do. The best thing that we have in our lifetime is our kids. And that's why the University of New Mexico is here, for our kids. And we need to give our kids the very, very best. Because it sends a message that they are important. You get that? That's the best thing we have is our kids. And Mitch Garver became that very important guy because he was the best catcher in the United States his senior year and got drafted by the Twins and went on to be the best hitter in the Twins organization the next year after that. What a fantastic thing. And it just told me what can happen. One more story. In 2010, you'll see that 2010 up on the board. We're all about putting numbers on that wall. I want that wall covered in numbers. I want it to look like a math problem out there. So 2010, I did it one more time because I'm crazy. But I see our kids and they're not so sure of themselves, and that's our job to make them sure of themselves. It's to make them know that they're as good as Texas. They're as good as California. They're as good as Vanderbilt. Wherever, it doesn't matter. Pick somebody, we're as good as they are. Giving them confidence. 2010, we walked out onto the floor of the pit. And I saw my kids and I went, you know, I'm not sure they're sure. So we introduced our team. And they handed me the mic. And I said, okay, Lord, here I go. Ladies and gentlemen, this is your University of New Mexico 2010 baseball team. We opened the season at Texas against the number one team in the country. They're the best pitching staff in the history of Texas University. And we're going to kick their butt. And we're going to bring their horns back and set them in this gymnasium at the end of the year. The horns are in my office right now. 10,000 people from Texas. 10,000 people from Texas watching the game every day were in shock. And you know what they did? When we got out of the shower to get on a bus to take our 14-hour bus ride home, they came out and said, we're very impressed with your kids. That's who we are. We're the University of New Mexico. So, who are we? That's much better. Thank you for having me. Thank you for being here.
I'm Ann Rhodes, alumni president, signing off for the evening. Thank you so much for coming.